Greetings, students. Hope you're doing well. Today we're going to talk about a very different view of learning. This is a behaviorist view of learning, and a behaviorist view of learning does not include any of the cognitive components that we've addressed with Piaget or the social context and the way that Vygotsky addressed it. Behaviorists are looking at enduring changes in behavior that are not a result of maturation, but they are a result of experiences. There are different classifications within the behavioral school of learning. One is classical conditioning, and the other, which involves involuntary responses, emotional and physiological responses to stimuli, and operant theory, which involves permanent changes to behavior, learning that occurs as a result of consequences to the behavior. The philosophical background of behaviorists can go all the way back to Aristotle. I'm sure you do not want me to do that, and I won't do that. I will mention, however, we could go back just to John Locke, around 1600s, who suggested that people are born a blank slate or tabula rasa, and you'll hear this term, so I'd like you to know where that comes from. We are born tabula rasa or a blank slate, and the experiences we have write upon the slate. The individual is a passive recipient of his or her experiences, which write upon the slate and thus form the person. The epistemological question, or the question about how we come to know, is that there's a notion that it's not the inner cognitions of a person, but the actual objective reality of a situation, and it is experiences with that reality by which the person learns. It's an empiricist or empiricism point of view. Knowing through sensory experiences is called empiricism. And implied in this notion is that some simple experiences can be associated together to form complex ideas about the world. The other reason that this theory is liked is because there's a notion that it's a very deterministic theory. If I know how people have behaved in the past, I can predict how they behave in the future. And that gives some sense of comfort and control. When we talk about classical conditioning, these are the terms we're going to address. And let me go on to give you another slide here of some examples. And you can go back and look at this. And then this is really where I'd like to land. Let me give you some tips about understanding classical conditioning. To the behaviorist, the word conditioned has the same meaning as the word learned. Always remember that. So in this, there's an unconditioned stimulus. Now, what's a stimulus? Anything that stimulates. It's very not a real deep thing here. And unconditioned means unlearned. So what this first box says up here is that there is some unlearned stimulus that elicits an unlearned response. In the previous slide, they had used the example of a balloon that burst. And if a balloon bursts, you're going to flinch, especially if it's near you. The neutral stimulus that they used is the image of the balloon. Now, this is how events are before the learning occurs, in which the balloon is brought into what used to be this neutral stimulus of a balloon is paired with the sound of the bursting balloon, which is the unlearned stimulus. So it's usually this is a one-time event for an example like this, but especially if this happened more than one time, you would certainly learn from that. The unconditioned stimulus is a bursting balloon, and it is going to cause anybody to flinch. If paired with that is the image of the balloon, and these are paired together one time, two times, three times, What's going to happen is what used to be a neutral stimulus is now a conditioned or a learned stimulus. And what is learned? It is flinching is learned. You're flinching now to the visual image of the balloon and not to the sound of a balloon bursting. So let me give you some more tips here. Let's look at this. Unconditioned means that this is a naturally occurring stimuli. This is neutral means this previous to the learning situation, this had no meaningful response on part of the learner. These two get paired together. It could be one time. If it's a very scary situation, it might take only one pairing. Sometimes it has to take multiple trials over and over again. Now, such that this neutral stimulus gets paired and it becomes a conditioned stimulus. So we only have two stimuli to begin with. At any point in time, we have the sound of a balloon bursting and we have the balloon. And the balloon has gone from a neutral stimulus to a conditioned stimulus. Now, how many responses are we talking about? Let me give you a second to think about that. We're talking about only one response. Flinching. I don't know. Fear. Some other kind of surprised response. Flinching to the sound of the balloon bursting. Here. And now the same flinching just to the sight of the balloon. So we're only ever talking about one behavior. In our communications with each other and any homework assignments or anything you want to communicate with me, I suggest that you set up your communication about classical conditioning using this paradigm, using this diagram. It makes it so much clearer for you and for me. You can look at this and make sure to yourself, am I submitting an activity where the responses are the same? And the only difference is what elicits that response. Here, it's something that's naturally occurring. Down here, it's something that I learned to respond to. Let me tell you, and I think that you can see from this, is that this accounts for a lot of the development of a lot of phobias. Everybody can think about a situation like that happened to them where maybe this occurred. Let me share with you my situation. Maybe that will help. So when I was a child, I was walking to school, going through some rustling leaves. It was fall, rustling leaves. I lived in the Midwest, big trees, lots of leaves on the ground, everything's hunky-dory. Then there's a dog running at me that's going to attack me. That is, I'll guarantee you, for a young child, an unconditioned stimulus that elicits fear. So let's say my actual physical experience was to be startled, and I became startled. Now, this neutral stimulus only had to be compared one time with the sight of an attacking dog. It was a big dog, such that immediately afterwards, just the sound of rustling leaves, I found startling. So again, what used to be a neutral stimulus of the sound of rustling leaves as the dog's running at me through the rustling leaves, the dog attack, of course, made me startled. And now it was paired with the sound of rustling leaves, which now elicit startledness or fear. Does that make sense? I hope so. Now, you have read in the textbook about Pavlov's, I don't want to say this, the discovery, I guess that's the right word, the discovery or the popularization of this notion of classical conditioning by Pavlov, a Russian physiologist, Nobel Prize winning physiologist. He was studying the salivation of dogs as a way of studying their digestive systems. And so what would happen is he had a dog hooked up. They were studying they were capturing saliva from the dog, and so they would present food to the dog. The dog would salivate and eat. What happened after a while is that the dog would begin to salivate when the individual walked into the room with the bowl of food. Now, I can guarantee that this was not Pavlov himself. It was probably a graduate student of his. Came into the room and brought the food. And now the dog, whenever he saw the graduate student, would begin to salivate. Now, rather than thinking that my experiment is surely spoiled, Pavlov made use of this observation. I always find this so remarkable that there are some individuals who serendipitously are able to recognize the value of novel responses. So he began to study this notion of the conditioning with the food as the unconditioned stimulus and the salivation as the unconditioned response. So rather than just the individual, the graduate student walking in the door to feed the dog, he set up situations where he would test different neutral stimuli. In this little illustration on this on the screen, you're going to see it says a bell was rung and a metronome was used, and all kinds of stimuli were used as neutral stimulus, and it always elicited at the end salivation. Now, if you go back in your mind and think about the graph that we just had on the screen, the responses are on the right-hand side. So first it was the food elicits the salivation. Then there's a neutral stimulus added to this. It could be a bell, it was a metronome, different kinds of things. And the dog is salivating. And at the end, he's salivating to whatever the stimuli was used in association. The reason I bring this up, I belabor this point a little bit, is that Pavlov measured the salivation, the UCR salivation and the CR salivation. And it had the same, there was the same amount and the same chemical composition. And I say this because I don't want you to think that the salivation to the, and here's a bell ringing for me. I wonder what that is. I'm going to stop the, well, actually, I'm not going to stop. We'll let the bell ring for a minute here. I think that's pretty funny, isn't it? So let me go back to saying that the salivation that was recorded as a conditioned response had the same chemical composition. People might think, oh, well, it's not really the same. Yes, it is really the same. It's the same fear. It's the same startled effect. It's the same salivation. And I think that's important to remember. Okay, now I include this little cartoon because I think it's, you know, I like to do this kind of thing, and it's really clever. Watch what I can make Pavlov do. As soon as I drew, he'll smile and write in his little book. And there he is, ringing the bell over here. Excuse me. So that's our little seventh inning stretch. I do encourage you to look at the YouTube videos that are available regarding Pavlov's experiment. There'll be a link on the website, our website, as well as you can just go to YouTube and do searches on that term. I think you really need to be familiar. It will help you, I think, if you see the actual early studies. I think there's a BBC YouTube that's very useful that way. I've included here some ideas, and I'll go through each of them. And these are associated with classical conditioning. some of the terms you're going to come across